let's kick things off then by taking a look at the best 11 from game week 23, where we have two Leeds players at the back with Melier in goal and Stuart Dallas both getting double-digit returns in their victory over Palace. Dallas is joined in defence by Fulham's Kenny Tete and the mighty Lewis Dunk, who scored in Brighton's 1-1 draw at Burnley. In midfield, we've got the superb City duo of Foden and Gundogan, and after that incredible 4-win at Anfield, they make the team. And then we've got a few surprise entrants, actually. Almiron is in the team, Jorginho and Decore. Up front, Timo Werner makes the cut after getting two assists against Sheffield United, just as we've all shipped him out. And completing the lineup, it's DCL, who managed a goal and an assist in Everton's 3-3 draw at Manchester United. A nice late goal for him.
Yeah, it was a nice late goal, but bad news for anyone who's got DCL in their squads is that he, midweek, after scoring in that incredible game between Everton and Spurs, then went off with a hamstring injury. Now, 500,000 managers have brought Dominic Calvert-Lewin in this week ahead of Everton's double game week fixtures. So that's put a bit of a spanner in the works, hey, Az?
It has, and I think it's going to come down to, if we get any news tomorrow, what we do with him, because I think lots of people have got quite strong benches at the moment, the likes of Watkins on the bench or Souček, now he's had his ban overturned. So he could come in if he's going to be out. So you might not, if you just brought him in, you might not need to take lots of hits to take him out away. You could move him for Richarlison, maybe, who's around the same price and might be playing more central. Or you keep him, but you just got to hope he doesn't miss one game and just comes back for City.
Right. Hamstrings, I always figure it's going to be maybe at least three or so. I shipped him out myself straight away last night. Sam, what's your plan?
I'm waiting. He had a scan today, so I'm just waiting to see whether we get any news ahead of the deadline. If we do get some news, then I might follow you, Mr. Richardson, and do him out for a certain young man called Harry Kane that I'm missing greatly at the moment. but there are, you know, it is a double game week, and I really don't want to take out a player who has a double game week if there's a chance he plays in both those games. So it's going to be a wait and see for me right up until that deadline.
OK, well, Dominic Calvert-Lewin was on my bench, your bench and on yours, Az. And this seems to be a popular theme of this season, is managers benching players when they get big hauls. We weren't the only three to bench Dominic Calvert-Lewin. Over 500,000 managers benched him. Over 750,000 managers benched Martinez in goal as well, who picked up 9 points. Dallas there with over 300,000 managers benching him for his 12 points, which was amazing for him. Bamford's on that list. He's been a difficult one to know when to start this season. Even Harry Kane on there as well. But it seems to be a common theme, doesn't it, Sam? Us benching players when they deliver points. But it's common, isn't it? What do we do about this? Is it actually a positive thing in that we've got the right players, it's just hard to pick when to play them because of the unpredictability of this season?
Yeah, I think it is. And I also think it comes down to the fact that there are so many big hitters that are either injured or not performing right now, that people have a lot of money in their FPL banks to spend, and therefore they've upgraded their benches. So in a normal season, we probably have a load of 4.5, 5 million players sat on the bench. They'd bring in 1 or 2 points here or there. But now we're talking about having players like Bamford and Dallas on our benches who are worth a lot more in terms of budget. And the inevitability of that is that you end up with points sat on your bench. But fundamentally, that is probably a good thing in the long term, because if you ever need your bench, you're probably getting some decent returns off of it.
That's true. Among the many managers who doesn't know quite what to do with Patrick Bamford is Patrick Bamford himself. We had him on here last week, in fact, talking about his travails as a FPL manager. And this week he's been at it again. After Leeds' 2-0 victory over Palace on Monday, in which Patrick scored, he was asked by the television cameras whether he'd brought Rafinha into his team yet.
You know what? I don't, but I captain myself, so... And let me tell you, after I missed that one in the first half, I was kicking myself, so I'm glad I scored.
He loves his FPL, doesn't he?
Loves it.
Az, have you got Patrick Bamford and have you got Rafinha in? And should he be kicking himself for not having him in?
Yeah, I've got Bamford in. I think most people have. 6 points is he's kind of at the stage now where you're not really getting huge rank boosts when he scores because he's so popular. So Rafinha's really nice to pair with him, because Rafinha's in great form, really low ownership, and just looks class. And the understanding and partnership they've got looks like they're going to get lots of goals together. So, match made in heaven.
Well, they've got that double game week coming up next week, and we'll look at some more Leeds options a little bit later on.
Yeah, we will. Also, you may have noticed on that bench list was Harry Kane, who nearly 300,000 managers benched him. I mean, it was kind of understandable going into the last game week because he was injured and no one was expecting him to return for the game against West Brom, but he did, Sam. Mm. He also scored in the cup in the week as well. Does this mean that Tottenham are back as a team in terms of FPL?
Yeah, I think Mourinho caught us all out a little bit by starting Harry Kane against West Brom. And I don't think any FPL managers were really expecting it, hence why there were so many of him sat on people's benches. But yeah, I do. I think it makes Spurs... You saw the lift that it gave the whole Spurs team. And OK, it was against a West Brom side who haven't been great. But even so, Spurs were so, so much better. And even in the FA Cup game against Everton, they played with much more attacking threat and managed to score four goals, which you wouldn't have seen a couple of weeks ago without Harry Kane. So yes, I think it is time to start reinvesting because the Spurs fixtures are quite nice going forward after this game against Manchester City too.
So coming up, we've got game week 24, the double game week. Four teams in action twice across the game week. And probably the most appealing of those is Manchester City. They've got both Everton and Tottenham. Everton away, Tottenham at home. So let's start off by looking at two of their assets who are listed as midfielders, but certainly add a lot of attacking threat. İlkay Gundogan and Phil Foden. Sam, for you, who's the better of the two as an option?
It's Gundogan for me. I own him, have owned him now for a few weeks, and he's been really, really nice to own. He seems to be Pep rotation proof. He plays every week, pretty much, and is returning on a regular basis. And I can't see that changes anytime soon. He's in such good form. He seems to have taken that David Silva role at Manchester City and made it his own. And they were really missing that in the earlier part of the season. Foden, I think, looks good. Trouble with Foden is you never know when he's going to play and whether he's going to get benched. And that is a real headache for us as FPL managers.
Do you think, Az, that if you've gone for Gundogan, is it better to go for Foden in addition, or do you still prefer having Gundogan and two defensive options?
Yeah, I think that's the key decision is this week, is what you target. And the fixtures are difficult. I mean, Spurs is Mourinho is going to park the bus. City might find it hard to break them down. And then Everton, I wouldn't be expecting them to score sort of four or five goals. So at the moment, I've got two defenders and Gundogan, and I'm sort of relatively happy with that. But if you really want to attack the game week, then I think Foden is the perfect player to get alongside Gundogan. Mm. And really, if you're comparing the two, I think purely for this double game week, I think I actually put Foden a little bit higher, given the form he's got, given the fact he's been starting these big matches. But over the season, I think Gundogan will outscore him because of what Sam said. He's just a safer, rotation-free option.
Okay. It's an interesting point, though, about the Spurs clash, because the last two times they've come up against each other in the Premier League, Man City have had, I think, 41 shots across the two games, but lost both of them 2-0, and in the Champions League as well. Spurs, of course, got the better of Pep's side. But assuming that they are going to perform, is Raheem Sterling another option we should be looking at? He's got three goals in his last four games. He's got very low ownership as well, only 13%. Is it the rotation that puts you off there? Because the differential potential is pretty huge.
Nothing puts me off him this week. I think if I was building a free hit team or if I was starting my team from scratch, he'd be the first name on my list and he'd be my captain straight in. He's got that look about him. He just looks sharp again. He looks hungry. He wants to get goals. And I think he's going to play both matches because I think Pep is going to try and keep
You don't have him in your team at the moment?
I don't. And I can't, with the three already in place, it's hard for me to move for him, but I want him.
Right. Sam, have you got him?
No, I don't. It's the price tag that puts me off because you've got to upset a lot of other apples in your team in order to bring him in. He, you know, at 11.6, it's not like bringing in Foden at 6.1 where it's an easier transfer to do. It's difficult to get to Foden, but if you've got lots of money in the bank because you've downgraded KDB and you've got that money still sat there, then I think he's a really great
Sterling?
Pick. Maybe, but even then, Salah's returned in his last three games, so it's difficult to take him out right now. And I think Liverpool need a bounce back. So Manchester City, yes, it's a great fixture. Yes, Sterling, he goes on runs and he seems to be getting into one of them right now. But I don't see these two games being that high scoring. I don't think that they'll put a lot of goals past Spurs or Everton. And therefore, there's a potential ceiling to how many these players can get this week.
That makes it sound like to me then, Sam, you would prefer to go for two defensive City assets and just the one attacker in Gundogan. It's 11 clean sheets in the last 14 Premier League games.
Yeah.
It's outstanding when you look at the numbers in terms of how many goals, and they're not even conceding a lot of goals in those games. So would you suggest you have to have two City defenders, or are you still OK with just having one?
I just have one. And I think I'm OK with that. So it's been my debate this week as to do I go by Cancelo, know that there's... Because there's so much attacking potential with him as well.
Which one do you have?
I have Diaz.
OK.
So I could partner him up with one of the other two, but Laporte's back in now, so that worries me a little bit in terms of Stones. Cancelo, I think, has got the ability to play in midfield, so I think you're fairly safe there. But the fixtures do put me off because, again, I think that there is a chance that the likes of Spurs with Son and Kane back together again could score. Everton have seen, we've seen from them in midweek that, you know, they're capable of scoring goals. So are the clean sheets there this game week? I'm not sure.
OK. Yet.
It's not the easiest run, is it, Az? Which of the defenders do you have?
I've got Cancelo and Stones. Cancelo's just one of those players who I'm just going to keep all season thing. He's so fun to own in your team. You watch him play, bombing forward, you know, dropping into midfield, like you say. And Stones, I mean, scored again against Liverpool, disallowed, fractionally offside. So he's got a bit more attacking threat about him. I think Laporte is a threat, but at the same time, he hasn't put a foot wrong, so why would Pep break up what's been working so well for them?
Yeah, but who knows? I guess the one guy at the back who might be rotation-proof is Ederson, the keeper. Mm. And the other thing about him is that Pep, once again in the last 7 days,
I can't believe he's doing this to us.
Taking penalties after Gundogan missed from the spot.
It's every time there's a double game week, he turns around and says, I might let Ederson take a penalty.
He knows. He secretly plays FPL, doesn't he?
So is there any case for having Ederson as one of your Man City picks?
I think the biggest problem is it locks you out of being flexible with the defence and with the midfield. And even with Jesus as well, if he starts hitting form. Because changing a defence around, your midfield around is OK, but having to make a goalkeeper transfer is something that I really don't like to do. So, and he's very expensive as well. And I think, you know, with Pope and with Martinez, I think they give you the same for cheaper.
Now I have to say Thomas, yeah, because he's invaluable and I think he has something like... magnet in your head or in his boots. Aaron Cresswell, because he's executor almost all our set pieces and his left foot is unbelievable. Mikey Antonio, because he's very strong and it's hard to defend, so I hope we will have a penalty finally. I have to say again Aaron Cresswell, and I wish maybe me, yeah, so we will see. Declan Rice or Said Benrahma, and again Aaron Cresswell, yeah, because his kicking off set pieces is a very, very good level. Again, Tomáš Souček or Declan Rice, and now maybe Jesse Lingard, yeah, because in his debut against Aston Villa was unbelievable, and I hope they will be continue in this performance.
We are joined now by the number one FPL manager in the world, live from Bergen in Norway, Ulla Hovde. Ulla, thank you so much for joining us. First of all, congratulations. Unbelievable that you're top of the pile. You're where every single FPL manager wants to be. And what's even more impressive is you've been there since game week 10. How have you done it?
Well, thank you for having me. And... I don't know how I've done it. There's no secret, but it's like consistency. I try to get as many points over longer periods of time instead of trying to attack just single game week by single game week. And try to look at players who I can have for a long time and then kind of plan who I might transfer out, when I transfer them out, who I might transfer in for them. And so I guess like the secret is just to plan ahead.
It sounds
wow,
so easy.
Yeah, but I guess big part of that is holding your nerve. I've got so many questions for you, Ulla. First of all, your team's called Red Iluma. What does that mean?
It means straight to the pocket. So it's just like I'm taking the title.
Okay. Now, it sounds like there's a lot of prudence and planning that's gone into the way you've managed to rise to the very top. But if we have a look at your team for Game Week 23, the ones that's just gone by, there's also some pretty bold thinking there. Oh, my word, your three Man City players,
wow.
You stuck them all on the bench.
That is brave.
What made you do that?
Well, you'll never walk alone, I guess.
I get it. Is that the boldest thing you've done all season, or are there other similarly brave calls behind your success?
Well, of course, I didn't put them on the bench just because I'm a Liverpool fan. But I believe the other players had a bigger chance of getting points. And I can see it pretty much worked out because I wasn't planning on playing Bernardo Silva originally. I had Cancelo in for Justin, but I made the switch just last 5 minutes because I believe Justin had a big chance of getting a clean sheet.
Yeah.
Very nice. Yeah, great call. Really was a bold shout. Az, did you want to ask them?
Yeah, I was going to say, what surprised me with that is you're obviously not thinking too much about what other people are doing because Cancelo and Diaz are so highly owned and you weren't afraid to put them on the bench. Is that your strategy going forward, or are you going to be more conscious of the people around you, or are you just going to play your own game?
No, I just try to play my own game. And if I think about what all the other players are playing, if I think who they're playing, the other people who are top 10, top 100, then it's no fun.
And, I love that. It's great.
Of course, if I play other players, then I have a bigger chance of increasing my lead.
Yeah, I think that's my biggest problem is I care too much about what everyone else is doing. It's obviously where I'm going wrong. We're just taking a look here at the top 10 rankings in the world right now. You're obviously top of that, but you're 52 points ahead. That is an incredible gap over the second place player. We do know how quickly things can change. It's maybe two correct captain picks and they've caught up with you. So are you not even slightly worried and having a look at that number two team and having a look at who they've got and planning to kind of block their moves? That's what I'd be doing.
Well, I don't really check before the game week, but when the transfers are locked in and everything locks in, then I go and check the other teams because then I will also see like the updated version and what they're playing that game week. And then I start to, like, when I watch the games, I don't want their players, of course, to score and stuff like that. But before the game week, I don't really look too much at their teams and not on, like, the ownership of the player or anything.
He's so calm.
So I'd
be,
calm.
I would be freaking out.
I would be a wreck.
That's the thing. I'd be absolutely terrified. The last time I saw a lead that big, Ulla, was Liverpool last season in the Premier League. I'm just curious. Yeah. You've never had this big a success before, but right now you are number one out of, 7 million people in the world. What does that actually feel like?
Well, of course, it's awesome. But I've been number one for... Well, like, I don't know, 14 game weeks or something?
Right.
13?
Oh, so now it's...
Of course, I get the... What do you say?
Like,
I get used
to it,
but it's really awesome. It is. And I got a lot of people messaging me and everything, and that's pretty cool. It is.
Ola, so coming into this double game week, I know we don't want you to give away what you're doing because obviously it's so amazing that you have this lead.
Although you can if you want.
But you can if you, if you really want to. We did take a sneak peek at your team there from last week. So coming into this double game week, you already have three Man City players. Who are the must-have players to have for this double game week, do you think?
I think you have to have three Man City players. And I would love to have Sterling or probably Sterling instead of Bernardo Silva, who I have in my team. But I think three City is almost a must-have. And you should have probably like a Burnley defender because there's so many on the Burnley defense right now because they have two great fixtures coming up. And I originally had Calvert-Lewin, but now that he's injured, I don't know really what to make of that. But I believe he was important player to have for the double game week 24.
Okay. Whatever you decide to do about Calvert-Lewin, Ulla, get it done by 11 o'clock, as you know, on Saturday morning. Thank you so much for being with us today. And Lucatel, as I believe it said, for the rest of the season. I think I've just said good luck.
I'm not sure he did. He hasn't reacted, so I don't think that's right.
Well, anyway, never mind. Hopefully we'll be speaking to you again as the season wears on. We'll see how it goes. But best of luck, and thank you so much for being with us today, Ulla.
Thanks, Ulla.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Leicester City, Liverpool kicks off game week 24. And to make sure we get the weekend off to a good start, let's have a proper look at the fixture and how best to use our FPL assets in this game. Now, first of all, big news from the midweek cup action is that Leicester's brilliant James Justin is going to be out. Well, at least we think he will. He was stretchered off. So what do you think the plan is? What is the best approach for a man who was the second highest scoring defender in FPL?
This one's a really tough one because he got stretchered off. There was reports that he was walking again in the dressing room after the game, though, from Rodgers. So I think it's going to be another one of those wait and see to the last minute because, as you say, he's been on such good form. I don't think you'd want to transfer him out if he's going to come back in the following week. So for me, he'll probably just take a seat on my bench, which is where he was anyway, regardless of this, because of the fixture. Although I was planning to bench boost this week, but that might have just gone out the window with all of these flags. But I think you could safely put James Justin on your bench this week and then have the security of knowing that if and when he returns from injury the week after, you've still got him.
Yeah. Mm. OK, well, someone who has recently returned from injury for Leicester is Jamie Vardy. Now, he came on in the last game, got some minutes, started in the cup in the week. So it looks as though he's back to what you'd say is relative full fitness. And he's got just 14% ownership. So could you see him as actually a differential going forward?
Yeah, absolutely. And they probably had this game earmarked for him to get him back because it's such an important game for them. Maybe they thought they were going to be title challengers. But now it looks like it might be a really key battle in the top four because obviously Liverpool struggling and Leicester right up there. So he's absolutely key for Leicester, as we all know. He's an interesting one. He's not someone who looks great when you're looking at stats tables and all this kind of thing, but he's always a player who can score out of nothing. So it'd be great to have another premium forward come back into our consideration. But for now, I think there's better options around.
What have you made of the minutes he's got so far since returning from injury in those two games I mentioned? Do you think he looks like he could be a good option or not quite yet?
It's not quite yet for me. I think the midfield options look great from Leicester. They've been playing really well. And actually, they've been playing even better, I would argue, in his absence of late. He came back on. He looked OK, but he didn't set the world on fire. He does have penalties in his locker, and obviously that adds to the appeal. But for me, it's a little bit too soon. It was a very, very short window of time that he was out for. And it was quite, you know, it's a hernia operation. It's not nothing. So maybe he might just take a little bit longer to get back into it.
All right. In other Leicester players named Jamie news, James Maddison's been doing brilliantly of recent weeks in FPL. Earlier this week, actually, Kelly Summers caught up with him and asked him if he'd actually brought himself into his own team yet.
No. And do you know what the worst thing is, actually? The people around me in my league have all got me. So, you know, I'll obviously come off the pitch and I'll be buzzing that I've got a goal or an assist or something. End of the game week, I go and check my table and they're all still ahead of me and I'm thinking, how? Because I had a good... And they've all got me in, so... It's annoying, but it's all just a bit of fun, so I'd rather be scoring on the pitch and have to suffer in the fantasy, to be honest.
Well, fair enough, but we have the option to bring him in. What do you think, Ed? Should we be doing that?
I love him. I've always loved him as a player. I think my first ever show I did of these, I tipped him and he scored against Wolves and it was
nice.
Good moment for me. Interviews like that are great because he's such a great personality And it's really interesting because I saw an interview with him a few weeks ago where he actually said he's looking to add goals to his game. He's playing further up the pitch. One thing that's really surprising is Leicester have one of the worst successful corner percentages he takes. And I know he said as well that's something they're looking to address because he's such a good passer of the ball and such a good crosser. I'd expect him to be getting more assists from those kind of positions. And he's not. So I think he's great, and him and Harvey Barnes, one of them is going to do well for you.
One to keep an eye on, you think, for the moment?
I think so.
Right,
yeah.
OK,
let's move on to their opponents, Liverpool, then, and we start with Mo Salah, who scored a penalty against Manchester City last week. What are we thinking on Mo Salah, though, Sam? Because it's not really been the points that we've wanted from him in terms of how much he costs, but he does still continue to deliver.
Yeah, 3-3 now. And yeah, you're right. I mean, didn't see a lot else from Salah in that game last weekend, but the penalty comes and you get the points. And I think it's a tough one to take out the Liverpool team right now. The defence, I think you could lose. But with Salah, I think it's difficult because they're about to have, they've signed these two new centre-backs, so you're about to strengthen their side. That will mean that Henderson and Fabinho play further up the field in the positions where they normally are, which will add that spine back that Liverpool have been missing. Once they get that structure back in their side, that should give those attacking players the freedom to do what they did last season when they had the confidence in those behind them. They haven't played this week because they're out of the FA Cup, so they've had a week's worth of training together with the new boys. I suspect we will see a bounce from Liverpool this weekend. I can see them doing really well in this game.
They have a great record away at King Power. Quick word on the players at the back. First of all, someone like Ozan Kabak, one of the players they just brought in, arriving from Schalke. Is he worth getting in? And also, I read that Trent Alexander-Arnold got 24 points in this fixture last season. Could it be time for Trent?
And it was a time when everyone was doubting Liverpool and they were doubting Trent, and a lot of people sold him or benched him going into that match because I think the clean sheets had dried up for Liverpool and his attacking returns had dried up, similar to kind of what it has now. But he showed signs of it the other week when he got a double-digit return just a few weeks ago. So if I had him, I'd probably play him in this game. I think you play him every week because of the set-piece threat and and everything like that. But I think it's too soon for someone like Kabak, and we don't know if he's ready. We don't know where he's going to slot in.
Right.
We don't know what his threat is yet in that Liverpool side.
We're going to take a look at some differential options now for the teams playing in double game week 24 outside of Manchester City. So Everton, Burnley and Fulham. Sam, you've picked out a few options for us. Let's start off with Richarlison, who you actually picked before he scored two goals in the cup.
I did, yeah. So he actually helped me out in what he did in the cup this week. From the last four game weeks, he's third among forwards under 8.5 million for touches with 166. He's also top for take-ons in that same period. So he's getting in the right places, getting enough of the ball to suggest that there's going to be some goals there.
OK, what about Luca Dean now? Because he did pick up an injury, he is flagged, but we're hoping that he'll play. If he does, why have you picked him out?
Two assists in the last five game weeks, so starting to see the return to attacking returns from him. I picked him up mostly for the clean sheet potential against Fulham, because obviously I'm not sure that it's there against Manchester City, but there is attacking threat with him as well. So he is a little bit expensive, but there's potential that he does well this week.
OK, let's talk Burnley now. They've got two nice fixtures in this double game week, Palace and Fulham. Mm-hmm. A lot of people have got Nick Pope in their teams. Fingers crossed he starts, because he was flagged earlier in the week. But you've also picked out Ben Mee. Why him?
Captain adds that element to the game, fairly stable in that Burnley defence. You know that there's not a lot of rotation, and I think the double up is on for this weekend. He's also second for successful clearances for defenders in the last six game weeks. So in terms of bonus points, he's likely to pick them up if it's a very low-scoring game too.
OK, in terms of scoring goals, Burnley don't do it very often. They're the lowest scorers in the division. However, if they are going to score, is it likely to come from this man, Ashley Barnes?
I think so, yeah. He's not had the best of seasons. There's been a lot of injuries, a lot of missed games. He's not started very many. And in fact, he's only scored two goals over the course of the season. But he is the main man why Chris Wood is out. These are two fixtures where, if he's ever going to score goals, you'd expect it to be this time around. And with other players getting injured, and we've seen that with Antonio flagged and Calvert-Lewin flagged, maybe it's worth a punt.
OK, and if you're looking at a real differential and you're looking to get a Fulham player in, Ademola Lookman always looks so good on the pitch. The numbers aren't really there, but his ownership is around about 1%. Is he worth a punt?
He is for me. So he is second for goal attempts in the under 6.5 million midfielders at the moment. Only Gundogan is ahead of him. So for me, he looks like a really nice option. He also passed the eye test massively in game week 23. So if you're going to go with Fulham, who have a game to play in game week 29, we know. So if you're long-term planning, he might be a really nice pick.
Let's start off by looking at Sam's team ahead of double game week 24 then, Sam. A lot of injuries in there. What are your plans?
To panic. The Nick Pope flag's disappeared, thank goodness, so that will be OK. Diaz, I'm hoping he'll recover from his illness, so that should be OK. I'm waiting on news on my two front guys because Antonio and Calvert-Lewin I don't want them both if they're not going to play this week, is the reality. So I'll probably lose one of them and bring back Harry Kane. And I'll probably just leave Justin where he is. That team was ready for a bench boost this week, and then the flags happened, and all of a sudden, that has gone out the window. So it'll be one transfer probably, and then I'll hold the other one that I've got free for this week for the next double next week.
Okay.
All right, Az, let's have a look at your Azettes. There they are. Oh, you've got lots of flags as well.
Yeah. Yeah, and I was going to bench boost as well. It all looked great until this. I was going to move Son out for Rashford, and then I had a bench boost of Martinez, Antonio, Rashford and Dallas, which is pretty nice. I don't think I can do that now, but I might still do Son to Rashford and bench Calvert-Lewin because...
You're selling Son?
I want Kane, so going forward, over Son. So right. I can get in Rashford this week, and then I can look to work up to Kane over the next couple of weeks.
Let's find out where our experts' captains' armbands are going this week. It's double game week 24. I'm guessing it's going to be on one of the Manchester City boys. They, of course, have Spurs and Everton. Sam, who's it on?
Well, originally it was going on Dominic Calvert-Lewin, and I was avoiding the Pep roulette altogether with my captain's armband. But with the flag on Calvert-Lewin, obviously that can't happen. So as I only, of these guys, have Gundogan, he'll probably end up wearing the armband. I think his form is really good. I prefer to captain a midfielder than I would a defender, so it'll probably be Gundogan.
Okay. Pep roulette, toughish fixtures. Is there a case for ignoring Man City in this double game week and actually plumping for someone like Bruno, who returned last week, had a nice rest for most of the FA Cup fixture midweek and has got West Brom?
I know. Not just West Brom, but he's West Brom are at home.
Right.
And they are awful at home. And Man United are incredible away from home. Yeah. And Pogba's out, which means Bruno plays further forward. I'd be very, very surprised if Bruno didn't get it.
As who's going to be your captain this week?
It's between Gundogan and Fernandes. I'm leaning towards Fernandes.
Ooh!